The next item of business is a debate on motion 23622 in the name of Maurice Golden on the economy. Can I ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons? And I call on Maurice Golden to speak to and move the motion for up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today's motion is about protecting jobs by ensuring better support in three key areas: grant support, taxation, and clear, consistent regulation setting. On grant support, currently only businesses forced to close can receive the maximum level of grant support. Businesses which voluntarily close are being penalised. Whether this is to stop the virus spreading or because their business is not viable under the restrictions. Deputy Presiding Officer, that is grossly unfair. Those businesses should be able to claim the maximum level of support. But we know that even when businesses do qualify, it is often not enough. The Scottish Government's own calculations suggest that it costs an average of £3,300 a week to run a pub. But they are providing pubs with a maximum of £3,000, not per week, but per month. And it turns out that even with this low level of support, it will not be maintained.
Jamie Hepburn.
The member recognised that that's a false analysis, and of course that figure isn't the basis of those pubs remaining open. That's not the circumstances we're in now, so would he correct the record in that regard?
Maurice Golden.
I don't see it as a false analysis at all, because ultimately a pub with monthly costs of over £13,000 cannot keep going on that level of grant support. And from Friday, that support will be downgraded to £2,100 a month. Therefore, as yesterday's restrictions changed, this means that only 42% of pubs can open. So the warning from the Scottish Licensed Trade Association is that up to 12,500 jobs are at risk, and this still stands. There must be a rapid review of these grant support limits, not just for pubs, but for the entire hospitality industry and other sectors too. We were told about new support measures are in the pipeline, but there is no detail, and businesses cannot afford to keep waiting. In Wales, hospitality businesses receive £269 per day, over four times more than the Scottish Government provide here in Scotland. In fact, it is just £64 per day. Scottish hospitality receives the lowest support anywhere in the UK. The new measures should come up to at least that level, or can the SNP seriously claim that Scotland does not have the power or the funds to at least match Wales? They have shown they can act when they want, such as the Welcome Fund for the wholesale sector and today's announcements for taxi drivers and travel agents, which are welcome. But months into this crisis, why is it still taking so long to get support out the door? Taxi drivers were promised support 3 weeks ago. I've spoken to drivers on the ground, and I know their bills are mounting. When will they actually see a penny of today's announcements, and will any support be backdated? I would be grateful if the Minister could address that. Or the travel industry. I've been contacted by both travel agents and the SPAA, and they face a double whammy. All the challenges this year has brought, plus refunding last year's bookings. I am glad the Scottish Government have listened to our calls, but why has it taken so long? But there needs to be long-term support, because businesses that manage to survive into the new year face a new threat, a massive tax bombshell as bills for non-domestic rates come in. Only a few months ago, we saw reports of 300,000 planned redundancies across the UK. Workers at Debenhams, the Arcadia Group, Bifab, and many other small businesses face uncertain futures. And that is on top of the thousands of pub jobs at risk I mentioned earlier. The Scottish Conservatives want action to save those jobs. So we're calling for the SNP to do the right thing and extend the 100% relief for non-domestic rates for another full year.
Mr. Golden, take an intervention on that point.
Happy to take
Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Mr. Golan for taking an intervention on that point. Does he agree with me that the ability for the Scottish Government to be able to provide that 100% RHL relief has been contingent on the consequentials from Westminster? And thus, in order to make the commitment that he's asking for, will he join with us to make the call to his colleagues at the Treasury to confirm the position from their perspective for the next financial year in order to let us provide the support for which Mr. Golden rightly calls?
Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We already have £1.3 billion in extra funding from the UK government. And in addition to that, if the SNP had managed to grow the economy since 2007, we'd have more cash right now. Or if they hadn't blown hundreds of million pounds on ferries or even grew the unemployment rate at the same rate as the rest of the UK, we'd have 250,000 more jobs pre-COVID and we would have far more cash in the bank to fund this. But finally, Presiding Officer, I want to turn to the restrictions and the effect they have had on businesses. We all understand the need for restrictions. But in recent weeks, we have seen individuals and businesses trying to follow the rules in the face of confusing, often abrupt, instructions from the Scottish Government. For example, Perth and Kinross was put into Tier 3 with just over 2 days' notice. Or Midlothian, supposedly moving to Tier 2, only to be given just 12 hours' notice that they were staying in Tier 3. It is worrying the Scottish Government does not seem to understand that businesses cannot turn on a dime. How are they supposed to organise staff, stock and make other decisions with so little notice? That's why we are calling for a week's implementation period to give businesses a chance to adapt, and I repeat that call today. I also urge ministers to give businesses a seat at the table in making these decisions, carry them with you instead of expecting them to fall into the line. Deputy Presiding Officer, these are common sense measures from the Scottish Conservatives. And remember, it is the UK government that has saved 1 million Scottish jobs, helped more than 79,000 Scottish businesses, and boosted Scotland's budget by £8.2 billion to fight the virus. There is no reason for the SNP not to support our proposals today, other than that they have come from the Scottish Conservatives. So, to the members opposite, the decision is whether you want to score political points or save jobs. I move the motion in my name.
Call Jamie Hepburn to speak to and move amendment 236.22.3 for up to 5 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At the outset of my remarks, let me move the amendment in my name, an amendment I look forward to the Conservatives supporting. I couldn't help but notice in yesterday's Finance and Constitution Committee on parliamentary debate and parliamentary scrutiny that without equivocation or clarification, Murdo Fraser described amendments presented by Scottish Government ministers as credible and capable. Being a man of consistency, and as consistency is a matter that many of us have often had cause to reflect upon, I know he will demonstrate his continued belief in the credibility and capability of what ministers bring to this chamber for debate by supporting my amendment today, and will, of course, as he always does, take his party with him. Presiding Officer, there is no doubt that Scotland's businesses continue to be impacted by the coronavirus pandemic. Even with the easing of restrictions in level 4 areas such as my own at the end of this week, the circumstances that are unprecedented in our lifetimes remain difficult for them. I take nothing for granted and appreciate every sacrifice being made by individuals, organisations and businesses in every community across the country. The vaccination programme, which is of course in its initial stages, offers us all hope, but we need to appreciate that we won't see the full benefits until next year. So for the time to come, we'll have to continue to strike a balance between our health and economic needs in the time ahead. When the pandemic began, we moved rapidly to put in place a support package worth over £2.3 billion to provide lifeline support to businesses. And we continued to provide support through the strategic framework, as well as £30 million in discretionary funding for local authorities, which can be used to address specific needs of local economies, such as supporting supply chains, and we are committed to a second round of the newly self-employed hardship fund with an additional £15 million to support those who have been overlooked by and are ineligible for the UK Government Self-Employment Income Support Scheme. We recognise the need to provide ongoing support, and today the Cabinet Secretary for finances allocated further funding of £185 million to help build resilience for our businesses throughout the winter period. This package includes additional support for hospitality businesses, for taxi drivers, for arts venues and for travel agents. That is action by this government responding to the real challenges businesses in these sectors across the country are facing at this time. I'll give way very briefly to Elaine Smith.
Elaine Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to the Minister for giving way. Could you tell us when the applications for taxi drivers will open, please?
Jamie Hepburn.
We'll be working with local government colleagues on that just now, and we hope to open them as soon as possible. I'll be happy to come back to Elaine Smith with detail when that is available. Presiding Officer, just as it is important that we support businesses, so too we must make sure that we support their workforces. That is something that Mr. Golden's motion fails to mention, a mere oversight on his part, I am sure. I consider it vital that we take this opportunity to signal the importance of this to employers, and that's why my amendment cites the COVID-19 Fair Work Agreement we have jointly endorsed with organisations including the Institute of Directors, SCDI and the STUC, which underlines the collaborative approach needed as we work our way through this crisis. Turning to the motion before us and picking up on the exchange between Ben McPherson and Maurice Golden, I want to make clear that we would also like to be able to provide clarity for businesses on rates relief going forward, but it is difficult to do so at this stage. The limitations of the devolution settlement mean that our ability to continue to offer relief next year is contingent on the UK budget extending the equivalent policy in England and generating consequential funding. The Cabinet Secretary for Finance has been clear that should the UK government bring forward such an extension, we are committed to creating a tailored package of business support measures, including rates relief, that best meets Scotland's needs. So on that basis, Mr. Golden's assistance and that of his colleagues in making the case to their colleagues in the UK government would be welcomed. I didn't hear him offering it a moment ago, but we'll be happy to hear it any time he's willing to give it. Presiding Officer, on an issue that both my amendment and Mr. Rowley's mentions, we know that some larger businesses, such as supermarkets, have pledged to reimburse the Scottish Government for the rates relief offered at the outset of the pandemic. And I welcome that decision and call on other businesses who are able to follow suit to do so. But as we... How long
the Minister's just closing.
You'll need to forgive me, Mr. Golden. However, I have to say, ultimately, we could do much more to support our businesses and wider economic recovery if we had greater fiscal flexibility and borrowing powers. In that regard, the pre-budget scrutiny report by this Parliament's Finance and Constitution Committee is timely. Let me quote what it says on this issue. Without its own borrowing powers to fund day-to-day spending, the Scottish Government is largely constrained by UK spend and policy decisions when determining its own COVID-19 related spending and policies. Not my words, Presiding Officer, but those of the unanimously agreed report of the Finance and Constitution Committee. So this evening, I hope Parliament will unite behind the Government amendment to endorse that position, to endorse our call on retailers who can return any rates relief they don't require for the benefit of businesses across Scotland, to recognise that more needs to be done to support Scotland's businesses and to back the Fair Work agenda for Scotland's workers. Presiding Officer, I commend the amendment in my name.
I now call Alex Rowley to speak to and move Amendment 23622.2 for 4 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, thank you, and I will move the motion in my name. The idea that we could build some kind of consensus, I think, is important. I think we do need to build consensus because at the end of the day, people's jobs are on the line out there, and that's what we're actually talking about here, is people's jobs. As we come up to Christmas, many people are very worried. The furlough, which is widely recognised as having been the right thing to do, helps, but we are seeing more and more job losses and more worry.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you. Does the member think that workers at Bifab and indeed workers throughout Scotland have been let down by this SNP government?
Alex Rowley.
I think there is a wider debate to be had about how we build back, and specifically around renewable energy, then the country's been let down. And that's a wider debate that we need to have and be more ambitious for building back our economy in Scotland. But specifically on the motion and amendments that are in front of us today, I read this morning, the Unite Union survey of taxi drivers, and on the BBC this morning, there was a lady who was a taxi driver for Edinburgh on explaining the situation that taxi drivers find themselves in. So the government moving to announce the support for that particular industry is good, but we do need to speed it up because people are desperate. And the Unite survey, presiding officer, which was issued this morning, they surveyed over 200 taxi drivers, and 37% report that they have been earning less than 25% of their average earnings. 18% report that between 25 and 50% of their average earnings they've been earning. And for some 20%, 50% to 75% of their average earnings. So for a lot of these people who either are self-employed or work in firms, they've just really been left. And there's quite a number of sectors that are like that within the Scottish economy. So my plea there, more than anything else, would be that we have to work with the trade unions, we have to listen to all these sectors, and we have to be able to respond, and respond as quickly as we can. Yeah.
Just very Jamie briefly, because I recognise time is constrained, just to assure him, I meet the SDUC on a weekly basis, and in regard with taxis, I met with Unite to discuss this very matter, met with Pat Rafferty, so they have been influential in making this choice.
Alex Rowley.
Which is good news, but I actually want to quote Pat Rafferty, because he said, the stories shared by taxi drivers in our survey is heartbreaking and clearly shows a trade in crisis. The reality is, behind the figures, there are workers and families across Scotland who are in despair. So, you know, that's the reality, and the government must, and that's why we need to build a consensus, because we need to be able to respond to where people are in real difficulty, and we need to respond quickly. So in answer to the question to Elaine Smith, for Jamie Hepburn, when will this open, we need to move that forward. We need to be flexible. And there is a point there also about being flexible in terms of there's guidance being issued to councils, but the point was being made this morning that for some taxi drivers who are self-employed, maybe share a cab, so that they have outgoing finances to pay for that cab, the guidance that's been issued, they don't fit within that guidance, so they're being refused. And I did have this discussion with the Cabinet Secretary for the Economy last week, where, yes, we need local discretion for local authorities, but we've got to get a message across to local authorities that these funds are being introduced to help people, and we need to look at how we help people, and that's got to be the general acceptance of the principle that when businesses come, they're not simply told they don't fit the criteria, end off. Now, I've been making that appeal to Fife Council because that's the one that I've dealt most with, but the government needs to get that message out to local authorities. We want to help these people, not put barriers in their way. I'm out of time, presiding officer, so I will finish at that and move the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Rowley. One, please, to Patrick Harvey for 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I welcome the chance to take part in this debate. I doubt it will come as a huge surprise to the Chamber that the Greens don't back everything that the Conservatives have in mind in their bringing this motion to the Chamber. They repeat their call for a business advisory council, for example. This is a well-rehearsed argument by now, and I'll put on record once again my concerns that what this would turn into, if the government agreed to it, would not be a group of people advising on how best to implement public health measures, but rather a group of people lobbying within government against implementing public health measures. I fear that that's the way it would go if it was created, and I'm sorry to see that the Labour Party are now echoing a Tory talking point on this issue. On extending rates relief as well, I would agree that no doubt many businesses do need this support. Others don't. Supermarkets, for example, have seen high profits during the pandemic. This year has been awful for so many of us to live through. but it has been good for the profits of some big businesses. It's really important now that our tax policy seeks not only to protect those who really need support, but also redresses the inequality that's been exacerbated by COVID. And the difference between small independent businesses and giant multinationals is one example. So simply continuing with those rates relief without taking a different approach is not something I would support. And as for grant eligibility, I'd be fine with carrying out a review, but I suspect I would have a very different purpose for that review than Maurice Golden and the Conservatives. I've made the case consistently that the government should use conditionality in its grant support, incentives for ethical practices like payment of the living wage, and support for those employers who were already doing the right thing before the pandemic, that we don't want them to be the ones most likely to be tipped over the edge and forced to fold. Too often, when we discuss the economy, we only see narrow metrics like overall economic activity without asking who benefits from it, who bears the harmful impact generating that activity, and in whose interest does our economy operate. When we debate business support, too often we only see support to business owners without ensuring that it gets directly to the people who do the actual work in our economy. The Scottish Government certainly doesn't have everything right on this issue, though their amendment is certainly preferable to the Conservative motion. Ministers do place an emphasis on the Fair Work agenda, but during the pandemic, just as before it, they have been far too reluctant to place robust conditions on publicly funded business support to ensure that the support goes to ethical practices and truly sustainable industries. If they begin to do better, then we have a chance of ensuring that the economy that emerges from the trauma of 2020 is a better one than the low pay, low tax, low regulation, exploitative, unsustainable and unhealthy one that came before. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Call Willie Rennie for 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today's debate is a bit of a sideshow. It's a sideshow because the answers that businesses are desperate for are locked in a secret process of negotiating a trade deal with our closest neighbours in the EU. I can understand why the Conservatives don't wish to debate it, as it's been difficult to justify the self-inflicted chaos that is Brexit. And it is chaos that has gripped our country for getting on to 5 years now and has resulted in few of any benefits and a shed load of uncertainty and disinvestment from the UK directly impacting businesses that we are debating today. And it should be a stark warning for those on the SNP benches who think that the process of breaking from the UK would be any easier. If you want to predict what independence negotiations would be like, you don't have to look too far to find out what that would be. Businesses worried about their trade, people about their jobs, and young people about their future would never forgive politicians if we spend the next decade arguing about flags, borders, and the name of our country, when we should be focused on economic recovery. And that both the Conservatives and the SNP are inflicting this double chaos in the middle of a global pandemic shows what happens when you let destructive ideology override common sense. Our needle-sharp focus should instead be on the recovery. And today, that is the work of Finance Secretary Kate Forbes and the welcome statement that she made earlier this afternoon. I am sure that Kate Forbes will acknowledge, if she was here this afternoon, the constructive approach that I, my colleagues and others in the Chamber have adopted on the development of financial schemes for different sectors. I and others across the Chamber have made cases directly to Kate Forbes, but also Fergus Ewing, and we welcome the engagement from them. We've made the representations from business direct to them, and they have engaged and responded well. That's what we should be doing more of, not more debates about the Constitution. So whilst I welcome the support announced today, I do share the concern of Liz Cameron from the Chamber of Commerce about the urgency of the situation and the need for early payment if we are to keep these businesses alive. I have spoken to many who are thinking about closing up in a matter of weeks. And if we don't act swiftly, with clarity, and get the money out the door quickly, I don't think they'll be here anymore. And that should be an urgent position for the government to adopt. Companies like, for instance, in the tourism sector, self-catering businesses, B&Bs, guest houses, who were directly impacted by the travel ban on the indoor meeting rules, but they've not had any support through the government schemes so far. They've been in despair. Travel agencies who've spent the whole last 9 months getting money back for their customers from companies and from travel companies, they've not been able to go on furlough, and they've been desperate for support. Thankfully, the support is available today. I welcome that. Golf, tourism companies, very important for many parts of our country that have got some great golf courses. Their business has evaporated overnight as people are not able to come from far-flung parts of the world. Wedding venues who've been really struggling, taxi drivers, also coach tour operators, all good announcements today from the government. Again, through cooperation, we've worked on trying to achieve that and make it happen. But finally, I have to say I was puzzled and concerned yesterday by the decisions on the levels. We had, I thought, a clear, consistent and cautious approach, the strategic framework. It's very clear if you did this, if you got the levels down, if you got the indicators down, if you made sure you followed the rules, the result would be that you would go down the levels. But then a new set of rules were introduced yesterday with extra caution in place that we did not know about. Apparently, Christmas is a thing where people go shopping. We never knew that before. But suddenly it's a new rule in the framework. I think we needed clarity, we needed certainty, and we've not got that from yesterday's announcement. And I think the government have lost a certain amount of confidence. I'll conclude on that. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate and strict 4 minute speeches, please. We're a bit pushed for time. Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I draw members to my register of interests. Despite valiant efforts by businesses and their employees up and down the length of Scotland, there have been widespread job losses and a continuing air of uncertainty that's hanging over our cities and our towns as we reach the Christmas festive period. And on top of this uncertainty, resentment has grown amongst businesses at the lack of Scottish Government support, which they have been slow to deliver. The Chief Executive of Visit Scotland has just sent out an email, Malcolm Roughead, and he states that there is a high level of stress out there as everyone tries to stick to the rules whilst keeping their businesses afloat. And that really sums up what's going on out there. Presiding Officer, no more than this has been felt by Scottish hospitality and tourism industry. Restrictions meant that stays in hotels, self-catering and bed and breakfast premises dried up overnight. And let me put that in plain words by sharing with the Chamber recent findings from the newly formed South of Scotland Destination Alliance, which found that tier restrictions wiped out any prospect of visitors coming to the South of Scotland. An eye-watering 94% of tourism-related businesses had cancellations across the South of Scotland, and a third of businesses saw between 90 and 100% of their bookings disappearing. The consequences of these cancellations were stark, resulting in a collective loss of just over £1 million across the 83 businesses surveyed and £500,000 of income lost as a direct result of the introduction of Scottish tiers. True, restrictions that this chamber agreed and voted for, but this equates to an average of £6,680 per business. Businesses simply cannot make ends meet, let alone bear the cost of the bills that they're incurring from rent to wages and stock. Presiding Officer, only today, after sustained calls from the Scottish Conservatives calling on the government to get the cash out of the door, have we seen support for businesses left out, purely due to badly thought through government eligibility criteria, affecting wedding companies to taxi drivers to self-catering operators, and we await the detail on the latter. A solution is clear. Our motion calls for the Scottish Government to provide a cushion for businesses for what has been deemed 3 winters in a row by committing to extending rates relief for the sector, including retail, which David Lonsdale of the Scottish Retail Consortium supports. We've consistently called for a coronavirus business advisory council, which might have assisted the government to understand a bit quicker why businesses are falling through the cracks because of ineligibility. I'm glad the Labour Party amendment recognises too, and I thank Alex Rowley for that. I don't agree with Patrick Harvey that it would be a talking shop for corona deniers, and it's short-sighted of him not to recognise a collegiate approach. If I may, I want to turn to the amendment by the Minister. We agree that we are fortunate that Scotland has benefited significantly through the pandemic because of the scale of support to Scotland.
Excuse me, Ms Hamilton.
Yes.
There's two gentlemen being very rude whilst you're speaking, and I would ask them to desist, Ms Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our Union of Four Nations has wrapped its arm around Scotland and cushioned us from an unprecedented economic shock, protecting jobs and livelihoods to the tune of £9.5 billion. The Scottish Government's own independent economic and fiscal forecaster said in September, the largest increase in spending in Scotland has been through the UK-wide schemes. In addition, David Phillips of the Institute for Fiscal Studies highlighted the Scottish budget has been boosted by 14% since the projections set out in February. And as we know, this is largely driven by extra funding from the UK government. Struggling businesses aren't interested in politicking in the form of an SNP amendment. They know there was additional funding received in the spending review. That was weeks ago, and only today we've heard how it's been allocated. Policy choices are in the gift of this government. This is precisely why we had to bring this debate to the Chamber today. Businesses want answers, they want clarity, not an exhaustive wish list that delays addressing the emergency that we now find ourselves in. Time is running out, Presiding Officer, as my time is too. And Liz Cameron agrees, but she said, for many, January will be too late to save businesses, their owners, their families and their employees, and they will face economic ruin. Thank you.
Time is very short, as I said, so please bear it in mind. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Conservative motion calls on the Scottish Government to provide certainty for businesses next year by committing to extend the non-domestic rates, poundage freeze and the rates relief for hospitality, leisure and retail businesses into 2021-22. The Scottish Government did provide 100% rates relief for the retail, hospitality and leisure sectors for this year. It's difficult for the Scottish Government to make decisions for 21-22, as the Tory Government's spending review at the end of November did not provide clarity on their budget plans, specifically around non-domestic rates for next financial year. As the Tories are well aware, the Scottish budget is dependent on generating consequential funding via the Barnett formula. Scottish businesses need certainty, but so does the Scottish Government for next year's budget in order to continue to provide that support for businesses. Following the Tory Chancellor's announcement at the end of November, the head of business rates at the commercial property company Colliers International stated, "It's also worrying that the Chancellor has not mentioned a timeline for when he will announce on the rates issue. Although the statement today was not a tax review, it's inconceivable if he feels he can wait until the March budget to discuss changes to the business rate system. By then, many retailers will have made their plans for the forthcoming year, and many of these will include closures and job losses in anticipation of the big bills coming through the letterbox." As the Minister said, the Scottish Government is committed to creating a tailored package of business support measures, including rates relief, that best meets Scotland's needs. And it's important that the package is tailored to those who need it most. We have witnessed in recent weeks many supermarkets and discounters hand back £1.8 billion of business rates relief back to the UK Government following a backlash. The sector has been rightly criticised for paying huge dividends to shareholders while receiving taxpayer support designed to help business crippled by the pandemic survive. In a recent report, the KPMG UK retail sector trends for 2020 highlights that many retailers have fared very well during the pandemic, with some having double-digit increases in sales, including supermarkets, furniture and homeware sectors, DIY and those selling electronic goods. In addition, those high street brands with good internet presence like Argos, Next, Boots, Game and Wix are amongst the biggest winners. Yes, hospitality, leisure and most clothing and footwear retailers need our support, and the Scottish Government should provide that additional support when it is in a position to do so. I highlighted that the Scottish Government requires certainty in order that it can consider business rates relief for next year. And this position was confirmed by the Finance and Constitution Committee in its pre-budget scrutiny report. In its conclusion, it stated that the committee recognises the enormity of the economic and fiscal challenges facing the Scottish Government in preparing next year's budget. With the support of the Conservative members, it stated that without its own borrowing powers to fund day-to-day spending, the Scottish Government is largely constrained by UK spending and policy decisions when determining its own COVID-19-related spending and policies. For example, it would be very challenging for the Cabinet Secretary to continue with policies like business rates relief in its current form without Barnett consequentials. I would therefore ask Conservative members to support their colleagues in the Finance Committee and get behind the Scottish Government's call for devolved borrowing powers so that we can provide the tailored support that Scottish businesses need.
Just remind everyone that we are pushed for time. So can I have Graeme Simpson, please, followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is a really important debate and it's long overdue. The public health response to COVID-19 has been largely understandable. But let's be frank here. The consequences have been extremely damaging and life-changing for many people, and not in a good way. Livelihoods have been lost. The hopes and dreams of young people leaving school or university have been put on hold, maybe dashed forever. People have lost careers. All MSPs know that businesses have suffered. We all know that there's been a colossal response from the UK government because there had to be. And the Scottish government too deserves praise for the work it has put in. And that's why I was delighted to hear Kate Forbes announce earlier today that there will be extra money dished out on a sectoral basis. We've not been able to help everyone. People have fallen through the cracks. Maurice Golden mentioned hospitality, a sector that's not just important to those who work in it, but to all of us. It's been hollowed out, and I fear for what will be left, frankly. You can't force businesses to close and not fully reimburse them, but that's what's happened. Now, members will have received the email from the Scottish Beer and Pubs Association earlier, which highlighted the difficulties caused by keeping this city in level 3. They say that decision could cost the sector £3.2 million between now and January, and we'll see pubs close for good. That's not good. Too many businesses and people have struggled to get help. People like taxi drivers, mentioned already, and some sole traders, if they haven't been in business for very long, haven't had anything. Cabbies will have been pleased to hear about the £19 million from Kate Forbes to cover fixed costs, because as we heard from Unite the Union today, many drivers are regularly working 16 to 17 hour days, with a shift being determined as having been good if £50 is cleared. And the Unite survey shows that 30% of drivers have been unable to access any financial help from government support schemes. According to the Federation of Small Businesses, one in five of their members in Scotland have had no support from the Scottish Government. So it's quite right that we're calling for a review to see where the gaps are. For example, the COVID-19 Strategic Framework Business Fund is, on the face of it, a good idea. It's for businesses required to close by law or to significantly change its operations due to restrictions from November the 2nd. But go into the application pages on North Lanarkshire Council's website and answer no to the question, was your business trading on November the 2nd? And it says you're not eligible. Now, that's clearly a mistake. I hope it's a mistake. But this sort of confusion should not be happening. Now, let me turn to the idea of the Coronavirus Business Advisory Council. It would be easy to dismiss this as just another call for another task force, the kind of thing that opposition parties do. I've done it myself. But throughout this pandemic, Douglas Ross has been positive. His ideas have been helpful. He made this particular call in a speech to businesses, and he was right to do so because businesses, the job creators, should be at the heart of government decision-making. and he had some other good ideas, one of which was a call for the SNP government to cooperate with the UK government to ensure parity of taxes between online and physical businesses. Mr Ross is nothing if not an optimist. So let's repay that optimism by supporting the motion in Maurice Golden's name.
Gillian Martin, followed by James Kelly.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a tale of two responses. The response by the SNP-led Scottish Government for Businesses in Scotland and the response of the Tory-led Government for Businesses, where they have control. In Scotland, £2.8 billion was deployed to many struggling businesses quickly. Sectors hit particularly hard, like hospitality, retail and leisure, are given 100% rates relief. The Tories did the same for English businesses in those sectors, quite right. All four countries were covered by the furlough scheme, which was funded by the UK government borrowing money. Now, furlough money is a welcome thing, very much so, but it's not a gift, neither to the people of any of the UK nations, nor from the UK government to any of the devolved governments. It's paid for by taxpayers in the end, taxpayers in Scotland as well as other UK nations. Independent countries across Europe have their own furlough schemes, and if Scotland were one of them, we would have had our own. But let's look at where there were differences in the approach. In Scotland, support wasn't just made available to businesses who had to close. It was used to capture more types of businesses in Scotland that were eligible than were eligible for support in England, particularly supply chain businesses and sole traders. These funds include Strategic Framework Business Fund and the Local Authority Discretionary Fund. Other specific sectors have been helped, £17 million for the seafood and fishing sector, £11 million contingency fund for soft play businesses that did not qualify for other grants. Grants were provided to businesses who were required to close by law, and grants to those who had to modify their operations to stay open. The small business bonus continues to be a lifeline for small high street retailers who've seen their income drop significantly. 3/4 of businesses with premises in Scotland have got rates relief. Might it need to be expanded? Yes. But for those who heard me ask Kate Forbes that question, you'll have heard that it needs consequentials from similar actions in England for that to be done. Asking the Scottish Government to commit to spending in 2022 when they have no idea of their budget or the cost of Brexit is complete fantasy. And like many MSPs here, I'm advocating on behalf of businesses who haven't qualified but are still being very hard hit. I'm confident that Kate Forbes will work with me like she has with so many MSPs across the chamber. And I'm encouraged by today's announcement of a further £185 million of additional business support and the targeted support she's outlined for events, hair and beauty, venues, travel agents, coach operators and others today. This support has been advocated from members from my benches, from Labour benches, Lib Dem benches, Green benches and Tory benches. And Alec Rowley is absolutely right. We all have a duty to do what we can collectively to save jobs. But it's helping the many self-employed people that Scotland's finance and economy ministers have taken a markedly different approach to the UK Chancellor. Self-employed people are reliant on the contents of their tax returns up to April 2019 to be eligible for any UK government support. If you became self-employed after this date, and I've got many friends in this situation, you will have to apply for universal credit. Effectively, you will be plunged into penury. In Scotland, we've addressed this with the newly self-employed hardship fund. Phase one's already delivered vital emergency support to people. An additional support of £15 million will be made in the second phase. I would have been far more impressed with Maurice Golden if instead of asking for rates relief, which he knows the government can't commit to, that he got behind asking for targeted help to the many sole traders and freelancers who've been left behind, many of whom are women, incidentally, many of whom have lost everything and are working either in alternative minimum wage jobs or signing on to get by. But I guess those people don't vote Tory. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Call James Kelly to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is an important debate. I think there are two central issues here. How do we support jobs in the economy? And how do we ensure that money that's become available is distributed fairly throughout the country and is distributed to those businesses and individuals that actually need it? I think small businesses, we all know that throughout our communities, the pandemic has hit really hard and has had a massive effect and will continue to have a massive effect on businesses and jobs. You just need to walk down any main street to see that. There are businesses close to where I stay in Cambuslang that have never reopened yet since the pandemic struck in March. And small businesses are particularly hard hit and have struggled in these very difficult times. I also think linked to that, the whole issue of town centres and the way that people have started to change their shopping habits. More and more people have gone to shop online. But even once we emerge from the pandemic, you worry that some of the shops will be able to sustain because people have changed their shopping habits, never mind the impact that it's had on their jobs and their incomes. I think one of the issues that's got to be looked at is how we ensure that people who till now have fallen through the gaps in terms of business support receive the funding that has been announced today. For example, those who are freelancers previously have not been able to obtain any support, and also those that don't have an allocated business premise. I think a number of members have spoken about the issue of relief and also the monies that large retailers have returned. Earlier in the budget statement, Murdo Fraser referred to these retailers as great examples of responsible capitalism. Well, I think that these businesses could do so much more. There's no doubt that because they have been essential shops, they have raked in a lot of profits over the period of the pandemic, and their staff have had to work in very difficult conditions. And that's why I've been pleased to support the GMB trade union campaign, which is calling on ASDA to shut stores and distribution centres in order to give their hard-pressed workers a day off on Boxing Day in January the 2nd, so that they can spend some time with their families over the festive period. I think that is only fair and reasonable. Final issue I want to touch on, Deputy Presiding Officer, is that of youth unemployment. The IPPR recently forecast that youth unemployment could rise as high as 140,000 as a result of this. And many studies show that younger people are going to be harder hit as a result of the economic downturn from the pandemic. But I think that the £570 million that was announced earlier by Ms Forbes, we need to look at how some of that can be allocated to cities like Glasgow, which will be hard hit by youth unemployment. But I think there are big issues here, and we've got to ensure support for jobs in the economy. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
The last of the open debate contributions is from John Mason.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm very happy to take part in today's debate on the economy. And firstly, I would say how ironic it is that the party, which consistently argues for lower taxation and for the subsequent inevitable cuts to public services, has the gall to ask for increased public spending on business support. If the Conservatives are so keen on increasing public spending, I hope they would support a tax rise in the budget next year. Maybe they would support a windfall tax at a UK level. How about increased tax for online businesses and others who have done so well through the pandemic? How about an increase in inheritance tax or capital gains tax? Now, we have already heard claims that there was a magic pot of money sitting somewhere that Kate Forbes can endlessly access. But the members know that we have had evidence at committee that the Scottish Government has actually added to the resources received from the UK. Much of the consequentials have already been spent, and yesterday's letter to the Finance Committee and today's statement make that clear. Some has to be kept for a contingency up till the 31st of March. Most people, when they get their salary, do not spend it all on day one, rather they spread it out over the month, keeping some for the bills they know are coming up and keep some for emergencies, which are bound to happen from time to time. and in the same way we have to keep some money for consequentials up to the end of March. Looking at the actual motion itself, I was interested in the phrase, ensuring that business can access the support that they need. No government in any country can do that. Of course, we all want to help businesses as much as we can, but COVID is the enemy here, and it is causing the damage. COVID has hit our citizens' health, and it is causing damage to our economy. The UK can borrow to an extent, but even that has its limits. Over £2 trillion now and rising, that's something like £30,000 per head, that cannot continue. The UK and maybe Scotland can raise taxes, but we sadly cannot save every business. Are the Conservatives really arguing that no business should close and government should write a blank cheque for every business? That does not sound like normal Conservative policy, which, as I understand it, is that weaker businesses should be allowed to go to the wall. The Conservatives at Westminster have not given Debenhams the support that they need. Are they saying that as a mistake? Then the Conservatives call for certainty for business for next year, presumably meaning from April 21. Well, firstly, no one can be certain at this point what will happen in April. Secondly, how can we have certainty for next year when the UK Conservative government has refused to have a budget at the responsible time? That leaves Wales, Northern Ireland and Scotland having to set budgets in the dark. Surely members will accept that the UK is being irresponsible in this. Thirdly, the UK government has been incredibly poor at giving certainty to businesses with the furlough scheme, changing it at the last minute on several occasions. By contrast, countries like France have given much more of a long-term plan. And while I do welcome the furlough scheme and its extension, I hope Conservative members are embarrassed about the way their government has treated business. Fourthly and finally, on the question of certainty, where is the certainty over Brexit? If the Conservatives were not so fixated on the Constitution, they might do a better job of actually running the country and giving more certainty to business. Presiding Officer, I said I was happy to speak in today's debate. It makes it so much easier when the Conservatives are in such a weak position. Thank you.
Move now to the closing speeches. Now call on Alec Rowley for up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In closing, I would re-emphasise the importance of this debate. I want to pick up on a few points. Patrick Harvey, I know Patrick Harvey thinks that he knows everything, but in terms of the Business Advisory Council, I mean, what we're actually saying here, and I think it is an important point, is we need to be able to bring together trade unions, businesses, SMEs, and actually the point that Graham Simpson made is to see where the gaps are and see where things are working, because clearly had we done that earlier, we would have picked up on the taxi drivers earlier. And so that's an important point. Another point that Graham Simpson made in terms of the local authorities, and I would re-emphasise it again, is we need to get the message out to the local authorities that these grants are being put in place to help people, and we really need to see the local authorities take a proactive role where that's not happening. James Kelly mentioned youth unemployment. The interesting statistic is that people aged between 16 and 24 years old currently make up 50% of the hospitality workforce in Scotland, and youth unemployment has risen from 6.1% to 14.5%. So that's really important. And if you link that to John Mason's point about do we let weaker businesses go to the wall, most of these hospitality businesses, remember, the reason they're in this difficulty is because of COVID and the restrictions. These are viable businesses, and if we can support them to get through this period, then we will be protecting those jobs for when they come out of it. And that's why this debate is important. It's not about Scotland versus England or the Constitution. It is about what needs to happen and the fact that we need to listen to people to be able to provide support. In terms of rates relief, I think particularly for SMEs, and the point has been made that there are SMEs and other businesses that fall through that gap. Yes, it was right that Tesco and others have handed back the money, and we would all urge, I'm sure, others to do so. But there are SMEs out there that do qualify, they have to pay rates, and they are struggling. But I take Ben McPherson's point. you need budget certainty. And so the Finance Committee is right to say to the UK government that we need budget certainty in order to give that certainty to businesses, but also give that certainty to local authorities, which is fair enough. We will not oppose the government amendment today, because we do believe that it is about support for employees as well as support for employers, a point well made by Jamie Hepburn. And we need to look at how we get that support and ensure that the support is getting to where it needs to go to. But we would equally, you know, support the Conservative amendment, the Conservative motion, in terms of looking at where there's rate relief needs to be given, look at where there's more support that needs to be given, and give that support. Picking up on some other points, James Kelly also picked up on that point about support for workers and the GMB campaign that is now running. We need to recognise that shop workers and other workers have been equally on the front line. And while it's right to reward, and we support the government in terms of the rewards for frontline health and social care workers, lots of these other workers have had a very difficult 6 to 8 months on the front line. And we need to actually be saying to these businesses, it's a fair point that Patrick Harvey did make, we need to be saying to these businesses, we'll support you, but we expect you to support your workforce who are on the front line. And we need them to be treated with respect. And the GMB campaign for public holidays, not just for ASDA workers, but for all workers, is something I hope we would also support. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Call Ben McPherson for up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I think this has been an important debate in that it has emphasised from various different contributions, particularly from Alec Rowley, Patrick Harvey, Willie Rennie and Gillian Martin, that we do serve our constituents better in the support for business in this very challenging scenario, and that balance between the health measures we need to take and supporting jobs, if we collaborate, if we think collectively, and if we're constructive with each other. And also note Graeme Simpson's points in that regard too, because we must find that balance. And that's why, you know, when COVID struck, the Scottish Government rapidly put in place a business support package worth over £2.3 billion to provide that lifeline support to businesses and to use those consequentials from the UK Treasury and to enable businesses to close down safely and survive through the initial crisis, protecting jobs and livelihoods. And today, of course, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance has announced a further £185 million to help businesses build resilience across the winter. And it was great to hear such positive comment in today's debate about the difference that that will make in terms of what issues have been raised with MSPs across the chamber. We understand the economic impact that restrictions are having on businesses and the economic effect of that. Of businesses being required to close as well as other sectors. And we continue to work with businesses and our partners in local government, importantly, to ensure we understand all the impacts and how best to support effective businesses. And I think it's important for the Chamber to understand that both the civil servants and council officials have been working relentlessly to get grant funding out, and they deserve our respect and appreciation. And the sheer challenge of what we face together, of setting the criteria in a way to make sure that we do, yes, get money out the door as quickly as possible, but also make sure that we're mitigating against fraud and helping as many different areas of the business communities that have been affected within the limits of the financial constraints that we have. And I guess I would also just want to reassure the Chamber that I appreciate the calls for a Business Advisory Council, but the engagement that the Scottish Government has with the business community is extensive and regular and has been since the early days of this pandemic and continues to be so. Yes, certainly.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank Ben McPherson for taking the intervention. I just wonder if it is extensive engagement with businesses. Why is it taking so long to get it right, to get the timing right, to sort out the delays and to get the eligibility criteria right?
Mr. Bennett first.
Well, I would say that within the circumstances that we're in, and the considerations that we have to go through, it has been expedited at a remarkable rate and to the full credit of everyone who's been involved, and including the business community and the engagement that they have had with government and local government. This has been a remarkable collaborative effort, and I think that sense of collaboration and that sense of determination to help businesses is what we should take from today's debate, whatever the outcome of the votes. That's the most important thing. And this matters when it comes to non-domestic rates, because you know, we have to acknowledge facts in this situation. And the fact is that we cannot give non-domestic rates relief for retail, hospitality and leisure until we have assurance from the Treasury because of the constitutional framework that we're in. So work with us. Work collectively in order to urge the UK Treasury to give us clarity. Because we should be working together in this situation instead of playing party politics. And Maurice Golden said that we shouldn't play party politics. Well, I hope the tone from Murdo Fraser in his summing up is much more consensual and collaborative, because that's what this situation demands of us as MSPs in this chamber and as representatives of our constituents. And, you know, that sense of collective responsibility, staying with business rates, has been evidenced by what has happened in terms of some large businesses committing to give back, to repay the rates relief that they have had. And we will ensure that an appropriate mechanism is available for them and others to effectively donate the equivalent to government if they wish. But that will require collaboration with the Treasury, because donations to government isn't something that normally happens. So again, that's an area where we need to work together, and that should be what all parties should be focusing on in that regard. And I note the points that have been made around what we do in the budget next year, and we continue to engage, whether it's with trade unions or business organisations, and with all parties on what is going to be an important budget in the months ahead. In conclusion, we are doing what we can to meet the ongoing challenges of COVID-19 and support economic recovery, but we need the UK government to give the Scottish Government the additional funding and assurances, and also the powers we need to respond. And the position around fiscal flexibility continues. And I know that a lot of members reference this, and I'll just reiterate it, that the Scottish Parliament's Cross-Party Finance and Constitution Committee has now unanimously agreed that Her Majesty's Treasury should reconsider access for the devolved governments to emergency borrowing during this crisis. So it is essential that the UK government take action, and I urge members to support our amendment. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. And can I call on Murdo Fraser to wind up on this debate?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, this has been a very timely and important debate, because I think every single one of us, whichever part of Scotland we represent, will have been contacted every day by constituents, by businesses, by people who are self-employed, people who are employed, concerned about their economic situation and looking for financial support. Rachel Hamilton talked about the situation in tourism. That would be very familiar to anyone who represents really any part of Scotland, but in particular rural areas where, you know, tourism is an important part of the economy. We've had big issues in parts of the country like those I represent, which have been in Tier 3, which, you know, technically in Tier 3 are still allowed to operate, but because of the travel restrictions that have been brought in, their customers are not able to travel. And that's been the big impact, for example, for those providing self-catering accommodation, technically not having to close, but their customer base has disappeared and not up till now getting the support that's been required. Maurice Golden raised the issue around hospitality, and we heard earlier this week from the Scottish Hospitality Group about the support for pubs, and the information they provided was quite striking, because what they said was the average support for pubs in England was £80 per week, in Northern Ireland, £147 a week, in Wales, £269 a week, but in Scotland, just £64 per week. And I think that's put into context the remarks we had from Gillian Martin earlier, who was saying how well the Scottish Government were doing in relation to other parts of the UK. That is not the case exclusively. There are areas where Scotland hasn't done so well. The evidence suggests otherwise to what Gillian Martin suggested. Now, Ben McPherson exhorted me to be consensual in my winding up. So, of course, I don't want to disappoint him. So, in that tone, can I welcome again the announcements we had from the Finance Secretary a little while ago, the sums of money being paid out. Of course, UK Treasury money, of course, £8.2 billion in the current financial year being paid out to support tourism and the wedding sector and taxi drivers and the travel industry and all the other sectors we know about. And that is very welcome. And, you know, we should be not equivocal about that. It is a welcome and people are looking forward to these announcements. But we cannot see a delay in that money being paid out. And I read earlier the comments from the Scottish Chambers of Commerce in response to Kate Forbes's announcement, and they were very clear. There are businesses which cannot survive long into the new year. And if this money is not getting paid out until January or later, that is going to create a real problem for many of them. Nor can we have the sort of problems that Graeme Simpson identified with applications. Now, absolutely right, local authorities have done an extremely good job trying to handle the number of applications for grant support and other financial support. And it has put a huge burden upon them, and people in local government have worked extremely hard to deliver this. But there have been mistakes, and we need to be very careful that barriers are not being put in the way of businesses who need this vital support. Now, I want to turn and talk briefly about the amendments in the debate. And I'll start off with Alex Rowley's amendment. And Alex Rowley didn't actually talk very much about his amendment when he was speaking, which is a pity, because it was actually a very good amendment. In his amendment, he makes reference to the money being handed back by the large-scale retailers like Tesco and Morrison. And that is very welcome. And I agree with what Mr McPherson said about the need for the Treasury to cooperate with the Scottish Government to make sure this money comes back to Scotland. And I read the letter from the Finance Secretary to the Chief Secretary to the Treasury about that. But that could potentially be another £200 million coming back into the Scottish Government's budget in the current year, which could be available for business support. And when you add that together with the £300 million held in reserve, that's another half a billion pounds potentially available for supporting businesses and all the other things we need to do. So, you know, let's not hear too much from the Scottish Government when they say every penny is accounted for. There are resources available there. Now, let me... Yes, of course. Yeah.
I just Cameron. Wonder if he can set out how he will take forward and assist the process of raising with the UK government the necessity of putting in place that mechanism so we can get that nearly £200 million.
Oh, I have an excellent working relationship with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury, and I speak to him on many occasions, Presiding Officer, and I'm very happy to do what I can to oil the wheels of that particular process. Now, let me turn to Mr Hepburn's amendment, seeing as he's tempted me, because I think he quoted me saying yesterday that Scottish Government amendments were credible and capable. Well, Presiding Officer, sadly, there's an exception to every rule, Presiding Officer, when we look at the amendment today, because I'm sorry to say, Mr Hepburn's amendment just seems to be the usual whinge about the lack of fiscal powers, not recognising, as indeed the report from the Finance and Constitution Committee said unanimously, the benefits of the fiscal framework to Scotland in protecting the Scottish budget against a decline in Scottish tax revenues, providing that is in line with what happens elsewhere in the UK. And of course, we never hear from Mr Hepburn or his colleagues in the SNP how they would fill the black hole in the Scottish public finances if we went down the route of standalone finances in Scotland, a black hole which accounted to £15 billion a year, even before a penny was spent on COVID. They don't want to hear this, Presiding Officer. And let's just remember, the cumulative fiscal transfer from the rest of the UK to Scotland in the period from 2007, since the SNP came to power, amounts to what? £62 billion. A fiscal transfer of £62 billion. They never want to talk about that, Presiding Officer. And it is a little bit ironic that they're talking about the public finances in the very day when we read a report from a committee of this Parliament talking about, and I quote, a catastrophic handling of ferry contracts costing the taxpayer £200 million. £200 million this week. Last week it was BIFAB. £50 million of taxpayers' money down the drain, Presiding Officer. You would think, Presiding Officer, before demanding more fiscal powers, they'd want to demonstrate they can use the ones they've got a little bit more effectively. But, Presiding Officer, I think I probably have to wind up, Presiding Officer. There's much more I could say. Mr. Russell's heckling me from a sedentary position. Oh, I'm so sorry, I don't have time to give way to Mr. Russell. It's a huge disappointment to me. in this particular debate. I'm never tired of hearing from Mr. Russell, as you know, the presiding officer. Can I just close by saying, I think there's been a welcome debate, actually. There have been some good announcements today made by the Scottish Government. There's some good contributions from all sides about what more needs to be done. Businesses need to have certainty and security for the future. That's what the motion in the name of Maurice Golden says, and that's why the Chamber should be supporting it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fraser. And that concludes our debate on the economy.